gates and doors were barred and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness, rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow, half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. Feet began to rattle, a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they've moved him in the night, none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone in the empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. How or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Something strange had happened there, but just what, I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, then I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. It was when at last it came, the choices I denied, I knew his name. Even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. And every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive.
good morning, everybody. Welcome here. Let us start with Jesus cried with a loud voice, "It is finished." And today is the day that he rose and he is alive. He's alive indeed. Hallelujah. Let's open in prayer. Oh, gracious Father, this day that you've given us, that your Son rose from the dead, that his blood covers the sins of all that accept him. Thank you, God, for sending him to us. Thank you, Jesus, for what you did for us, what you went through for us. Thank you, Lord. Be with us now as we go through the service today, Resurrection Sunday. Just accept our joyful noise, Lord, as we sing praises and open our hearts to the message you've given, Pastor, that we can understand, and those online that are wondering, let them listen and accept, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, let's have our doxology. If you can stand, please, and if you can't, don't worry about it.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Heart was the blood of Christ.
Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood.
Holy, holy, holy is his name. He lives, that we can praise him and live with him.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
How sweet to
He died for us.
Thank you.
Good morning, family. Some wonderful singing there today. Except for Brother Dan, I heard him singing. It's called A Joyful Noise for a reason. This morning, I want to thank you all for being here. I understand that to some, today, Resurrection Sunday, they look at this day as Easter. They make it about candy and children searching for eggs. When I was a child growing up, my grandparents used to gather the entire family, and we had 15 grandchildren, more, and we would bombard their house, and we would spend time together. So I understand how important today is, even for people who do not celebrate the resurrection. So I'm going to make sure that I don't keep you too long, because I understand you do want to spend time with your families as well. I have to tell you that I'm going to confess. I was blessed with the knowledge that I will be a grandfather soon. My daughter, Kelly, is going to give me a grandson, and I cannot wait to see him. But my first reaction was one of fear, because I thought about what kind of world my grandson would be growing in, what kind of world he would be seeing. You see, we're not supposed to be of this world. We're supposed to be in it. We're supposed to try and make it better. And I question whether I was doing enough to make it better for my grandson. But today serves as a reminder to us. Today reminds us, just as the song said, we can face anything because our Lord and Savior lives. And as long as He lives and He is with us, there is nothing, absolutely nothing that we cannot do. Nothing we cannot overcome. Please join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the people that you've brought in today, that they've taken time out of their lives to celebrate, Lord, the day that you have given them, the gifts that you have given them. And as we look into your words today, Lord, we see your truth. I ask that you guide us, that it may make us better people, that we may understand what it is that you have done for us. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. This morning we gather to celebrate an event that should have, in my opinion, the same level of excitement, the same fanfare as the day Christ was born. I've said this many times. It is a true belief of mine that this is equal in my heart to the day Christ was born. It's unfortunate that it's been relegated by most to the back of their mind, because this day is the day that completes what was started the day that Jesus was born.
Last Sunday, we looked at Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And Friday, we looked at the pain and the suffering. We looked at the torture that he faced before being sacrificed, crucified for us. He was sacrificed to atone for our sins. Picking up where Friday left off, I want to go ahead and continue. I'm going to read you a story. It's not going to be a 20-minute story about what happened, per se. I want to look at the importance of the day, not just what happened. After Jesus yielded up his spirit, the veil of the temple was torn into two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks split. The centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus, they saw the earthquake and the things that happened, and they feared greatly. They proclaimed, truly, this was the Son of God. When evening had come, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who himself had become a disciple of Jesus. The man went to Pilate, and he asked for the body of Jesus. Could have said no. But for the reason that I believe Pilate was against what happened to Jesus to begin with, Pilate commanded that the body be given to Joseph. So Joseph came and took the body of Jesus, along with Nicodemus, who first came to Jesus by night. He also brought with him a mixture of myrrh and aloes, they say about 100 pounds. Then they took the body of Jesus and they bound it in strips of linen. Now, a lot of people, they think of the shroud that's been in the news that depicts the body of Jesus. But we're told it was actually strips of linen, as the custom for the Jews. Now, understand that Jesus was a Jew. Whenever he preached in the synagogues and in the temples. So not unbelievable that his rite that they did for him when he passed would be the same as what they would do for a... Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. In the garden was a tomb, which no one had been... It was a new tomb. So they laid Jesus there. Preparation had been upon them. And because of that fact, they went ahead and they went to the nearby tomb. They had to hurry because they were under a time crunch. So they went to the closest tomb, which happened to be that one that had never been used. Knowing this, they rolled a large stone against the door of the tomb and departed. Everybody thinks, for some reason, that the Romans were the ones that sealed the tomb. But in fact, when we read scripture, it says that Joseph is actually the one who rolled the stone to the tomb. Now, of course, Joseph being a rich man, he absolutely had to have had help because we know that this is a very large stone. When they put the stone in front of the door of the tomb, I want to believe it's because of the fact that the body of the Lord and Savior was safe. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting opposite of the tomb when it was sealed. So they watched all the way till the end when there was nothing more to watch. Today's verses will show us the completion of God's plan for our salvation. In Matthew chapter 28, we'll be reading verses 1 through 10. I'll give you a moment to get there if you'd like to read along. It will also be up on the screen. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. Matthew 28, 1 says, "In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and become as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not, ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. As they went to tell the disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, All hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto them, Be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. When we read this, we understand that the women who went to the sepulcher, they went there because they were probably going to attend to the body of Jesus. They were the same women who were there until the stone had been rolled and shut. When it says that there were people there, there were soldiers there guarding the stone, the reason for that was because the Sanhedrin, the leaders of the Jews, went to Pilate and said, We don't trust that somebody's not going to try and steal the body of Jesus. We don't trust his disciples. So we ask that you send sentries to stand guard to make sure that his disciples don't steal him. That's why there were actually guards standing out there watching the tomb. The morning the women saw the stone rolled away, we know Jesus didn't need the stone rolled away so that he could leave. The stone was rolled away so that all could see that the tomb was empty. I spoke Friday evening on the importance of the cross. Today I want to look at the tomb, the fact that it was empty. And what does that mean to us? A lot of times, just like behind me, we have a depiction of the open tomb. People focus on the cross and they fail to see the tomb. There's actually religious people that have crosses with Jesus still hanging there, as if in perpetual agony. Jesus is not on the cross. He came down from that cross. He rose from the dead, and he is alive today. He is not there, just as he is not in that sepulcher he was placed. The first thing that we need to remember about that empty tomb is that it tells us that Jesus is alive. The resurrection of Christ is the foundation for Christianity. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15:17, And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Let that sink in for a minute. If we did not believe, if we didn't know for a fact that Jesus arose and is alive today, we'd still be in our sin. We would still be condemned. There would be no eternal life. But we know that's not true. Jesus is alive. Here Paul makes a grand statement, though, because he continues in 1 Corinthians 15:20. He backs up what he says when he says, But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now he makes a comment about the first fruits. Now, in order to understand what the first fruits means, in Jewish time and culture back in Jesus' time, first fruits was always the first fruit that was born from the trees that they planted and they harvested. Some would have the opinion that the first fruit was always the sweetest, was always the best. So he makes a statement, he declares what is indeed true, Christ has risen from the dead. Which is even better news for us. Because we believe that Jesus rose from the dead. We believe that he is alive today. Christ has not and was not the last to be risen from the dead. Because we are told that in his resurrection, we will also be like him. 1 John 3:2 says, Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, he being Jesus, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. It is a blessed assurance that we have that in our beliefs, in our knowledge that's given to us from God in the Bible, we will be risen again just as Jesus was. Just as God raised Jesus back to life, he will collect all of us who trust in Christ. Because Christ is alive, we can rest assured that every word that God said is true. Everything that God told us would happen came to pass. Which means God's word is fully truth. Why is that important? Why is it important that we know that God's word is fully truth? Anybody who was here last Friday, or even if you weren't, let me explain. We read Friday that Jesus told Pontius Pilate, after Pilate said, Are you the king? Jesus gave an answer that was not exactly direct, but Jesus said, To this end I was born, and now for this cause I came into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Jesus is saying, I am completing the truth. I am the truth and the way. This morning I asked you, or I will ask you now, actually. I didn't ask you yet, but I will ask you, are you of the truth? As you sit here today and you hear God's word, do you believe the truth? Do you believe that Christ died for your sins and then rose from the grave? I pray that you do. A living God means that he can be there for us. A living God means that he can listen to our prayers, that he can console us when we're in pain. And he still tends to his flock today. Christ's sacrifice was to pay for the penalty of our sins. In Isaiah 53:5, it tells us, But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. Some people may wonder, what exactly are we healed from? What does it mean that we are healed? We are healed from the eternal punishment that we rightfully deserve for our sins. The problem with worldly people is they feel like they don't sin. They feel like they have nothing to atone for, which is wrong. We know that's wrong. As believers in Christ, we've accepted the fact that we are sinners, that we know that we cannot do anything to save ourselves. This healing forgiveness can only come about through the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus died to give us a new life. 5:17. If any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. Today, do you sit before your Lord as a new creation? John 10:10, Jesus said, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. In thinking about this, if you are truly saved, think about your life before you were saved and how much better it became after you found Jesus Christ. Or better yet, after Jesus saved you. We celebrate the resurrection because it confirms promises that Jesus made. It confirms that we are saved through Him, just as He said we would be. It confirms that we will and do have a relationship with God, and that Jesus will return someday. It's the proof that Jesus was really the Son of God, just as those centurions, those men who saw what happened when the veil tore and the earth quaked, they proclaimed He truly was the Son of God. We know this to be a fact. This day is truly a day that we should rejoice. Unfortunately, like I pointed out Friday, and some people were taken aback by this, but there are people who listen to what Jesus went through. They listen to the torture. They hear how Jesus rose, and they say, I don't buy it. I don't believe it. Even though there are scientists and doctors that can explain exactly what Jesus went through. They can explain how He died. The ones who say, I don't listen to anything that's written that can't be proved. We can prove how Jesus died. We can prove all the things that are said, that were described, that our Lord and Savior went through. And yet they still choose not to believe. The thing is that they're not the first. I've preached previously about the disciples and their disbelief. And I'll quickly explain. In the book of Mark, chapter 16, it talks about Mary Magdalene going to tell the apostles the good news. The fact that Jesus had resurrected. And in the verses, in verse 10, it said, and she went and told them, and they had been with Him. Meaning they knew. Jesus had told them exactly what was going to happen. The disciples knew. The apostles knew. As they mourned and they wept. Now you would think, if Jesus told you, I'll be back, why would you be mourning and weeping? It's because in their hearts, in their deepest part of their hearts, they did not quite believe everything they had heard, everything they had seen. So they mourned the loss of their teacher. 11 says, and they went and they heard that He was alive and He had been seen of her, but they believed not. After that, He, being Jesus, appeared to another in the form, unto two men, as they walked, and went they into the country. And they went and they told it unto the residue, meaning they went back to the disciples. They told them, we saw Jesus, He's alive. Neither believed they them. So again, the disciples did not believe that Jesus was alive. Mary Magdalene told them. Two other people told them. Yet they still chose not to believe. Verse 14, afterward, He, again being Jesus, appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them. He scolded them for their unbelief and the hardness of their heart, because they believed not them which had seen Him after He had risen. So it's not unbelievable to think that there are those today whose hearts are so hardened they just can't believe it. It's just too much of a fantasy for them. When even the disciples of Jesus, the men who walked with Him, who ate with Him, had a hard time believing. Before the triumphant entry into Jerusalem, Jesus spoke to disciples and he told them, "The Son of Man shall be betrayed into the hands of men, and they shall kill him. And the third day shall be raised again." Yet they didn't believe. If the disciples who were told by Jesus himself that they would be that he would be raised and didn't believe, then how do we think that we can change the minds and the hearts of those who don't believe now? And the answer to that is faith. Faith that our Lord still works today. Christians can sing, as we have today, about our Lord, about the fact that he is risen and he lives today. They can read the accounts in the Bible. Sadly, even knowing the accounts in the Bible, even singing, some of them may not truly believe, just as the disciples. It's not enough to just know what happened. It's not enough to just sing about it on Sundays. You must truly believe that it happened. You must truly believe the sacrifice that Jesus made for you. When the disciples saw Jesus after the resurrection, they worshiped him, but not before they doubted. I can be confident in letting you know that at one time I doubted, before I was saved, before I believed. And if I can change, anyone can. I want you to ask yourself, do I truly believe that Jesus Christ died for me, for my sins, and raised, and is alive today? And I know I bring this up a lot, and this is part of the reason why I was saved, is that my father-in-law preached, just as a lot of Baptist preachers do, "Are you crucified with Christ? Nevertheless, you live, but not you. Christ lives within you." Do you carry your Lord and Savior, your risen Savior, with you? You should. It should be a badge of honor to say, "I am crucified with Christ. I know what he suffered. I've been to the cross. And I rejoice in the fact that he is with us today." Ask yourself, will I truly worship Jesus as my risen Savior, or will I doubt him like the disciples? I think we're all a little guilty of that from time to time. Paul talks about those who know in their mind, they know what the book says, but it doesn't change their lives. It's important that we know, when we realize, when we rejoice, when we carry the Lord with us, it changes our lives. We are made anew. In Romans 1:21, it says, "But although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened." Many Christians today fit that description. Many Christians today show up on Sunday, they worship, they sing the praises, they listen to the pastor, and then they walk out the doors and they live worldly lives. They allow society to tell them how to act, what to believe. When what we should truly be doing is allowing God to work in our lives, allowing him to guide us. Things have got to change. There are two kinds of people in the world that I've seen. Those who hear the gospel and respond to it by giving their lives to Christ, by following what the Bible tells us we should be doing. And there are those who hear the words of Jesus Christ and then go on living according to their own desires, according to what's right in their own eyes instead of what's right in God's eyes. The question is, which one do you want to be? As one pastor put it, every day you get to choose which one you want to be. Every day we are made anew. We have the opportunity to serve our Lord every day. question is, which one do you choose every day? It's not a one-time deal. It's not a, I believe today, and I'm going to go about my business tomorrow. I'm here today to proclaim it and to rejoice in the fact that Jesus came down from that cross. He conquered death and is alive today. I've said it in past, and I'm going to say it again until I'm probably blue in the face, till all who will listen. This day, Resurrection Sunday, we are meant to celebrate just that, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. This Sunday is not to be celebrated because of candy. It's not to be celebrated because of a little bunny rabbit. It's meant to be celebrated because a living Jesus can heal us. It's meant to be celebrated because a living Jesus can save us. It's meant to be celebrated because a living Christ can forgive us. And it is meant to be celebrated because a living Jesus restores and cleanses us daily. He can grow and renew our faith even when we're not sure. He can guide us. That is why the empty tomb is so important. That is why it's important that we focus on the fact that Jesus was not there. It's because it tells us that Jesus is risen and living with us today. As we gather in fellowship, we do as fellow believers in Christ. I'm going to ask Brother Bill and Brother Tino to come up. Partakers of the Lord's Supper should be those we fellowship with, those who believe in the sacrifice that was made for us. The Lord's table should not be for just anyone. It's forbidden to those who live in open defiance of God, those who sin against God. Those who partake at the table of the Lord have no place at the table of the world. The Lord's Supper is meant to be a memorial service of sorts. It's an act of symbolism. We are to remember the body of Christ that was given to us through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. I'll ask Brother Tino and Brother Bill to ready the things that we will be passing out. And if you will, please pass those out.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you.
With us Friday, you can partake of the Lord's Supper again today. There is no rules against it. As we prepare to take the bread, represents the life that was broken for us. In the same way we prepare the cup that represents the blood that was poured out for us, we celebrate with joy in our hearts for the salvation received through these sacrifices. I ask that you all bow your heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, I bow before you today in humility, and I ask you to examine my heart, Lord, and examine the hearts of all the believers that are gathered here today. Show us anything that may not be pleasing to you, Lord. Reveal anything that may be hindering us from our relationship with you. I know that I am your beloved child, just as everyone who is here today, having received you into our hearts and lives, and having accepted Christ's death as a penalty for my sinfulness, the price that was paid to cover me for all time, I can never repay. My desire is to live for you and to serve you. Now bless this to our bodies as I will read from Luke. Thank you, Lord, for the gifts that we do not deserve. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. I will now read from Luke 22:19, and we will receive the bread. And he took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. In this, do in remembrance of me. We receive the bread. And in Luke 22:20, likewise also, the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you in remembrance of what was given. We receive this drink. I am grateful for each and every one for being here today, and I hope to see you again. Brother Bill, can you lead us in closing?
Dear Lord, this day, it's a holy day. It's a celebration of resurrection. Your power to raise your Son for our sins. The thing you went through for us, Lord, that we don't have to. Thank you, dear Lord, thank you. Thank you for this message today. Those that are here and those online that have heard the message, Lord, may it touch and change lives. You can do that, Lord. All they have to do is ask. Ask and it will be given. Now be with us as we go from here and we start our week, Lord. Bless each and every one and bring us back safely next week. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.